celebrate and have a good time.
Well, one of the things that has really kept us together was, first of all, the desire to want to be successful in this business once we realized back in the mid-60s that we can really make something out of ourselves in the music industry.
In this edition of Cover Story with Kool and the Gang, we're going to find out why the career of this unique group of music makers could be described as one celebration after another. From their first album in 1969, the group as we know it has stayed together. Quite a feat in the music business. And we'll hear in their own words how they accomplished this. In the beginning, Kool and the Gang established themselves as one of America's foremost party bands, fusing jazz and funk. However, the mid-70s disco era forced the group to grow in a new direction, and they did. Now, in the 80s, Kool and the Gang has become the most successful pop R&B group in history, with more top 40 singles than any other artist, and with two multi-platinum albums in 1985 alone.
When I'm off the road and when I have the spare time, I like to come out to a gym or to a health club and work out, because it gives me a chance to relax and get my thoughts together. It also keeps me in physically good condition and good shape. And we're getting ready to go out on the tour this summer. We're presently working on our new album. And I'm sort of getting in shape, you know. So this is like almost like basic training again. The story goes back in Youngstown, Ohio, around 1959, 1960. My brother and I used to go up to this paint factory and get these old paint cans and empty the paint out of the cans. And we used to play, use it for kungas.
So we used to clean out the paint cans, right? And stick a piece of wood in between them, the screw, right? And then paint the stripes on it to give the, you know, the resemblance of wood, put a piece together to look like bongos. And they sounded good, and we just played them. We sat there and started playing paint cans. They had sound to them.
And then about, 3 years later, we moved to Jersey City, New Jersey. And finally, we were able to buy some real bongos and kungas. And eventually, we started our first group, which was called the Five Sounds and the Jazzy Acts. We met at that time in grammar school, Robert Mickens, Dennis Thomas, and a little later, we met the other guys in the group, George Brown, who was the drummer in the group, percussionist and writer, and also Charles Smith.
In the early days of Kool and the Gang, we did have a struggle for identity within ourselves, because we didn't know whether to be jazz musician or just go the full commercial route.
We performed our first date in New York City at the Apollo Theater. And at that time, there was a group called Willie Feaster and the Mighty Magnificents. And they had a record out too. When we went over to perform our first record, our first hit, which was called Kool and the Gang by Kool and the Gang, Willie Feaster and his group blew us off the stage, because they came out moving and stepping and choreography and the whole works. So that really started the wheels to turning as to really getting together and trying to develop our career, ourselves as musicians, to be now entertainers. So we went back to Jersey and went back to the training camp, so to speak, and back to rehearse and said, now we have to put a show together. It's more than just playing, it's entertainment, you know, you have to entertain the crowd. And that was the beginning of our quest to be successful. It wasn't until Power of Swingin' and Jungle Boogie and Summer Madness that we had the national acceptance. Two gold albums in a row. We were doing national tours from Johnny Carson to Mike Douglas, so we were definitely on the roll. Then things changed for us. Disco became very popular in terms of the disco sound from like 1976 through 79. Was more the straight bass drum beat, the violins, the strings, and the female background vocals. We tried to adapt to that, but also keeping our own identity. So the two albums that we released, one was called The Force, and the other was called Everyone's Dancing. It didn't sell, wasn't successful, with just very small sales on both albums. And of course that became a hard period for us.
It was trying. I guess it was tough to weather through it, but we held together as a group, you know, as individuals and human beings. We kind of weathered the storm and got through it.
In those trying times, we tried to figure out a formula to come back into the industry, into the marketplace. One of the things that we realized and that we had oftentimes discussed among ourselves is that we needed a lead vocalist.
Strong with every sense, baby, of your electric body. You rescued me from the fire of heartbreak.
Well, I was at home and I received a phone call to join the guys at the House of Music Studio in West Orange, New Jersey for an audition to sing background on their album. When the guys called me, I went there, and Cool's brother, Ronald Calise, we call him, he called me into the studio, and he started playing chord progressions, you know. He said, James, you know, just sing. I said, what? He said, just anything, whatever you feel.
We're gonna have a good time tonight. Let's celebrate. It's all right. Gonna have a good time tonight. Let's celebrate.
And later on, we started developing a sound around my voice. And we started centering things around what I could do. And that's how we established the new sound for Kool & the Gang, like 79, you know.
It's a celebration. It's a celebration.
We're kind of family. We grew up together. I believe, I would say we've seen each other more than we've seen our families on the road. We've been together more time in life than we've been with anyone else. And it's sort of created a bond between us.
You know, we grew up, you know, in Jersey in the rural areas, you know, on the street. You know, we were very street conscious. And you can always tell when you meet someone with that background. You know, because there's certain things that you do alike, certain ways you think that are very similar. And it's just a feeling of camaraderie there that you don't even really have to have a close contact with them. You just feel the vibration.
We just had our 15th anniversary this past January. Well, marriage life in the industry is not that easy. But my wife and I have been able to come up with a understanding of this is what I have chose for my life, to be in the entertainment world. And so we don't get a chance to be with each other the way that we would like to. But in the future, hopefully I will not tour as much, have some time off to where I can be home a little more than what I have been. Since like early 70s, we incorporated ourselves into a corporation. So we sit down, we have our board meetings, and we, collectively make decisions. I think that when you're in this business, you have to always look at that tomorrow there might not be any hit records. So you have to sort of secure yourself and make other investments so you can have that blanket of protection in the future, you know. But that's something else that we're working towards, and to really become a corporation and diversify into other areas as well.
Now that I am corporate, we share a lot of those duties together. But he's like designated as the leader.
We feel that too much who is given, much is expected of. And as musicians and entertainers, we are blessed with a lot in terms of our recordings and our touring and so forth and so on, that we feel that it's necessary to help, you know, for various causes. I think it helps build character and it builds the individual to want to reach out and help others.
Let's cherish every moment we have together.
we base our whole purpose of what we do on being sort of God-sent, you know, so we feel that it is a real purpose rather than just something to do and something for, you know, just immediate gratification, so to speak, you know.
I was in bed watching TV, and I saw this young man playing on some cans and boxes, and it was a CBS Bill Moyers show. And when I heard the sound coming out of these cans and boxes, at first I said, well, maybe it's overdubbed. It's real drums, and they just dubbed it in, you know? And then I'm listening closely, and I said, this is real. This guy's got these cans and boxes sounding like real drums, you know? And this, it moved me because it reminded me of myself when I was a kid. Buddy Rich once said, it's not the drums that you play, it's the drummer. And I think that he has a lot of potential, and I think he should go on to be an accomplished musician, not only as a drummer, but overall, all around, you know. All I can say is God bless him, and thank you. Thank you for giving me the chance to do something.
Involved with many groups as far as giving back and helping people. But one was Big Brother and Big Sister Organization. Another one was Color Sound Organization, which we were the first group involved with Color Sound, which started down in Atlanta about 5 or 6 years ago with Dr. Bell.
Well, Cool and the Gang was the first group to actively get behind Color Sounds as a vehicle for teaching inner city youth to read, write, speak, spell, and correctly pronounce the English language. So Cool has been philosophically and spiritually involved from our program since the outset, and you can say that they're the true champions of our cause.
Never lets me down, night, so I'm gonna do the best I can.
Want to be role models for every individual in this in the world, and especially really the children.
We try to be as universal as possible, open-minded, and try to help as much as we can. I think that being musicians is one thing, but also being humanitarians in terms of helping out various for various causes has also plays a important role. I believe that's a very important element in a group of our size to stay together.
The group is set up where different people have different fields that they hit, and one thing that I do along with concepts for videos and heading that department is working on the choreography on stage, for stage, and the production on stage. And this is one thing that I recently take a lot of pride in, because you know, I've gotten a few fan mail, just some fan mail about, I like the way you guys dance, or your show is high energy, you know, a lot of energy. James, you dance well, you know, and I never considered myself a fantastic dancer, but I felt I could dance, so that made me feel good, and that has really boosted me into wanting to become better at what I'm doing as far as dancing and choreography.
What's the plan?
Turned on the TV and I saw Cool and the Gang dancing to the song Emergency. It was on a TV show. It was on some show. They were just, you know, dancing. They were dancing, and I looked at the choreography, and it was just right on. It was slick. It was funky. It felt real. It just had all the right elements. Of course, these guys are great dancers, but there was a great choreographer there.
Right now, I'm starting to work on some some more choreography for an upcoming tour for this year. So, you know, you have to stay abreast of what's happening in ballet. Check those shows out, really, the break dancing, you know, look at that and try to use it the best that we can.
In terms of recording, everyone has input in the group. There's various writers. You will notice when you read the credits on the album cover, you know, everybody in the group writes. And I think that keeps the unity also, because the guys get a chance to expose his material in the group, you know.
What we do is we come up with our own musical ideas, and we record them at our each individual homes. And we get together after that point, and we present the material that we compiled ourselves. We get down to 15 songs, and then we go to what is the what we're looking for as far as this album concept is concerned. Is it going to fit whatever direction we're going into? And that also eliminates some of the songs from the process. We're listening and writing and rewriting and putting the songs in form and coming up with different concepts for the songs. You know, and hopefully we'll have a hit album. Incidentally, I like to throw this in. Our latest album, Emergency, just went double platinum this yesterday. And we're very, very happy about that. It's a plateau for us.
Lady, pretty as can be. No one knows her name, she's just a mystery. I have seen her maybe once or twice. One thing I can say, ooh, she's very nice.
I get a lot of motivation from the children on Fresh. Through my niece, Jacinta, and Rashid, Yolanda, and Gina, and then Cool's children. You know, that's like the street saying, Fresh. Fresh is like when you were growing up, it's cool. Yeah, like, I like the way you look, that's fresh, you know. And so I heard him talking about that. I said, Fresh, huh? So I grabbed that idea and put it down.
I'll give anything to spend the night with you.
We had fun on that video now. Because we shot that one in London. And, I forget the producer's name. But this guy was great. He was very creative. I gave him a concept about Cinderella and the things that he did, you know, with the carriage. He had the horsemen with these big bodybuilders who had manes on and everything, pulling the carriage and everything, and fat women, you know, playing the part, and this fairy godmother looked like Marilyn Monroe. You know, it was a lot of fun.
We try to have songs that can relate to many people. Our theme has always been unity, the universal approach, trying to reach as many people as we possibly can, and as relates to our touring around the world, throughout Asia, Africa, Europe, and being apart, if that is at all possible, of bringing about the world unity through our music.
Technology has evolved to that point where it's, touched all points of our lives, and including music as well. So in order to keep up, so to speak, I guess Kool & the Gang has to follow suit.
When you go on stage, if you're generally a good person, you know, you don't have to put on an act like, okay, now I'm going to have to show that I love these people. If you just live a good life and genuinely care for people and about the world or whatever you're involved in, that is going to follow you.
We've stayed together because we enjoy, we enjoy being with each other. We enjoy the business itself, and it's just a lot of fun doing what we do.
When it's all over, I really hope that I've done some good.
I want to broaden myself, and just be free to express all the God-given talent that I have.
Well, I guess after it's all said and done, and after we have passed away, I think that the group would like to be known as one who he left a impact on the world in terms of our music and what we have, you know, what we tried to do as it relates to the world and to the communities. Oh, baby.